So first, thank you very much for inviting me for and being here. It's really an honor to share some time with you and explain what we are trying to do at BBVA and how we are trying to apply all these amazing things that Paco has mentioned in our transformation. So first of all, let me explain for those who doesn't know BBVA what is BBVA. So first of all, BBVA is software. A couple of weeks ago, we have been trying to estimate the volume of the software that is enabling our current banking model. And now, in the 11 countries where we have presence, there are more than 400 million lines of code that are supporting our credit cards, our loans, our branches, our ATMs. What is an amazing number? It's not yet in the, at the level of Google or other players. But for example, we have more lines of code operating our bank than the Apple operating system, than Facebook. Second, BBVA is data. So nowadays, our estimation is that we have more than 2.5 petabytes of information and data stored in our systems, and the estimation is that in less than 5 years, we'll grow to more than 100 petabytes. And this data is being used for, obviously, regulatory purposes, to manage our operations, to create new experiences to our customers. But it is starting to become really, a tremendous number, and a goldmine in probably the new things that we have to do in the future. And third, BBVA are more than 50 million customers in all the countries where we operate that are becoming more and more digital and that are interacting with us mostly through digital channels, the mobile, our websites, etc., and demanding more and more customization on every interaction they have with us, etc. So what is our challenge and why we are trying to accomplish a massive transformation? So basically, our challenge is something that is shared across the banking industry. We are in an industry that is condemned to disappear if it does not transform itself dramatically. So we have been, in the last 20 years, an extremely successful industry, and we have earned a lot of money. But the reality is that there are a couple of things that are transforming it and that implies very big transformation. So these three things are mostly regulation. So the regulation in the last couple of years has put a lot of pressure in the banking industry, and there is new regulation coming that is going to disrupt massively again the banking industry and create new opportunities. So for example, in Europe, there are two regulations, PSD2 that will apply in less than 2 years, that makes mandatory for all the banks to open our data to third parties. And this is not going to be more something that banks could do, it's something that banks are obliged to do by the regulators. And the second big regulation that is about to come is a new regulation on data privacy for our customers that basically has two huge implications, not only for banking but for other industries, that is about data portability. So we have the mandate to make available all our customer data so that the customer could move it to other companies or third parties. And second, this regulation makes mandatory that the customers should give a consensus for every usage that we do of their data. And obviously, if you look on how we manage data, how the data architectures are designed nowadays, these type of things create tremendous challenges in terms of execution. The second driving force is the digital customers. So 20 years ago, the way customers wanted to interact with us was through the branch and to do very basic operations. Now customers, they want to interact at any moment of the day by any channel, and they want to feel special. They don't want to feel that they are one more in 10 million. They want to have the better offer, the better price, a real-time resolution of their needs, etc. And third are the new incumbents that they are not more a future menace. They are already eating small pieces of our value chain. And there are, the last estimation, we see there are more than 12,000 fintech companies around the globe that are playing in the payments space, in the loan space, in the advisory space, and some of them, they are as big as Alibaba, that is more than 3 times bigger than BBVA in terms of market cap. And Alibaba, for example, is one of the companies in the world that is growing more in SMEs lending. That is one of the most profitable lines of business, for example, in BBVA. So all these challenges that basically imply that if we do not change dramatically, we'll disappear in not a very long horizon, were the triggers to accomplish a major transformation. So the first step in our bank transformation is to define a new purpose that basically is bring the edge of opportunities to everyone. And the meaning of this purpose is more deeper than a generic phrase or a generic sentence. It's about changing fundamentally our mission and how we relate with our customers. So until now, most of the banks and also BBVA, we have been extremely efficient selling machines. So basically what we have been doing in the last 100 years was to sell products to our customers independently if those products are the best solution for the financial needs of these customers. And this type of business, it's not going to be stay here for 5 or 6 years. Customers do not want that. Customers, all of us, we have financial needs. We don't need loans, or we don't need mortgages, or we don't need credit cards. What we have are financial needs that need to be solved in the most efficient and effective way. And this is what banks and what BBVA we want to do in the next couple of years. We don't want to be more a very effective selling machine. We want to be a company that helps our customers in solving financial needs. What is really a difficult mission for people is really difficult to manage their financial needs in terms of investing money or saving money in the right way. And this is what we want to do. And obviously that has a couple of additional implications, like we need to optimize our cost by transaction, because customers 10 years ago, they go to the branch once a month. Now they are using their mobile app or their wallet, etc., tens of times a day. And in the future, once that Internet of Things and micropayments are integrated in our devices, etc., the number of transactions will continue growing exponentially. We need to dramatically optimize our time to market. So banks and BBVA and big companies in general, we are designed to do things in time period of years. Now we need to move to do things in days or weeks, as other digital companies are doing. And obviously, we need to put the customer in the core of everything that we do. So what are the key dimensions that are part of our plan? First of all is we need to move from being a multi-local company, so having subsidiaries in every country and developing products and software solutions once in every country, to something more global. Why? Because our competitors, and our new competitors are Google, Facebook, Alibaba, etc., they behave in this way. They are able to build one solution for all the world and deploy this solution in all the geographies where they operate in a few days. Second is we need to move to become a real-time company. So I used to say that banks, we are batch companies. And not batch only from the technical perspective. We have designed our processes, our governance, etc., so that to make every decision, to approve a credit or to offer a price to some of our customers, we spend a lot of time. And customers do not want that. Customers want that things happen in real time. If I need to finance the acquisition of a new house, I need to know the price and if I have the credit instantly. I do not want to spend 1 month doing that. Third point is open. So most of the banks, we have been extremely arrogant, and we ourselves, we have been extremely arrogant, thinking that we could do everything, and that we are smarter and clever than anyone else in the world. And what we have realized, probably in the tough way in the last couple of years, is that the community, that fintech, they have the talent and the skills to compete and win in our traditional landscape. So now we are forced, and we are not only forced, we think it's a great opportunity to open our platforms and to start creating those kind of internal and external ecosystems of people working together with us. Fourth dimension is becoming data-centric. I mean, the bank has never used data as a source of value. For us, data has been a way to support regulatory requirements, mostly, manage fraud detection, etc. But we have started to realize that data is the new goldmine for banking. And a couple of years ago, we have created a company called BBVA Data and Analytics. It's an amazing group of PhDs and data scientists that has started to show us the power of data, creating, for example, products like Commerce 360, that is a new product enabled by data that allows merchants to have a lot of information on the customers that are using the card in the shop or in any place. And now that should scale across the bank. We need to rethink completely our product offer so that the core of the new products in the bank will be no more a standard banking transaction, but will be data and customization, etc. And finally, the fifth dimension of our transformation is that it should be AI-enabled. And this is probably the element of the transformation that is going to disrupt more and that is going to differentiate more the banks in the next couple of years. Something that the banking industry 30, 40 years ago was being extremely successful integrating what the technologies like mainframe or client-server architectures have enabled. And we have been able to move from managing a few thousand of customers to manage millions of customers thanks to this type of technology. We have been extremely successful automating some of the core banking processes. Internet has created some impact in terms of, I mean, allowing customers to access our platforms and doing some basic operations through the mobile and the internet side. But what is going to transform dramatically things is AI. And we are already doing some kind of experiments on this dimension. For example, in Spain, we have been working closely with a small Spanish startup called Inventa. And basically what we have do is we have realized that the people in our branches, our branch managers, they used to invest a lot of time asking for the configuration of certain products that are very complex. So if a customer goes to the branch and asks, for example, for an insurance product, typically the branch people do not know all the details of every product. So they call to a back office to find someone who really knows about this product. And our estimation is that in the Spanish branches, we spend more than 200,000 hours a year doing this type of activities that do not create any value for our customers. So by using a very simple AI Q&A product from Inventa, we have invested less than 60,000 euros to make it possible in less than 3 months. We have been able to reduce these 200,000 hours by 50%. And our aspiration is to reduce it by 90% by the end of this year. So this is a very simple, very basic example on how to use AI and how to train this small Q&A bot with the questions that the branch manager are doing. And if we think on what will be the impact across all the bank and across all the knowledge-based processes that supports or enables a bank with this type of technology, I mean, the impact will be tremendous, not in terms, as Paco has mentioned before, of reducing the number of people that work in the bank, but transforming dramatically what is the focus of these people. And now it's mostly focused in operate products and doing very low value activities to really be more focused in our mission that is around serve in a better way our customers. And obviously, and I'm not going to do in detail, this is the aspiration, the starting point, I will say, is in the opposite side. So our technology is not global, it does not scale, it's mostly batch-based. Most of our products or most of our technology is product-centric and application-centric. Obviously, machine learning and deep learning and this type of algorithms and the platforms to support that are not in the heart of our platform. They are like satellites, and we do not operate as a global company. So what is the solution? And here I'm going to talk just on the IT side. That is my area of responsibility. Obviously, there are other work streams around transforming the way we do marketing, the way we do risk, etc. But in terms of technology, what we have started to build 1 year ago is a global cloud platform, cloud banking platform. And it's global because for the first time in the bank, we are building something that is really global. So one multi-tenant solution that supports all of our banks. Cloud, because it embraces the principles of cloud about elasticity, scalability, etc. And banking, because we have some requirements that are very specific to our industry in terms of regulatory compliance, in terms of security, in terms of auditing, etc. So the first component of this global cloud platform is a new technology stack. A new technology stack that is something completely different to what you could expect to see in a bank. And the first layer is what we call the IaaS, our infrastructure as a service. It's a global infrastructure that is an hybrid configuration based on OpenStack and SDN solution provided by Cisco and other things that are like Ansible for automate everything. And we are also using Amazon as a public cloud solution in those geographies and for those cases where the regulators allow us to do it. And we are doing that in the 5 regions where we operate because we have 2 main regions where we have already consolidated all the infrastructure that are Spain and Mexico. And then we also need to build a technology stack in Turkey and Argentina and Venezuela just because the regulators makes mandatory to keep the data inside the country. The second piece is to completely rebuild our data architecture. Our data architecture now is what you could expect in a traditional company. So we have very big mainframes where we manage what we call operational data, so the basic information on transactions and standard customer data. And then what we typically do is we have daily or weekly or monthly batch processes that moves this data to a data warehouse. In our case, it's based on Teradata. And we do monthly or yearly analysis of this data to create regulatory reports, etc. And now we are moving to something completely different. It's a standard Lambda architecture. So we are using a Spark, a polyglot persistence layer based on MongoDB, on Cassandra, on Neo4Java. And we are using Kafka as the integration layer. All this thing is managed using a Mesos cluster. This is to change completely the way we think on data. Now, the world's operational data or informational data will completely disappear from the language of the bank. And I mean, we'll put this platform in the heart of every new software development that we do. The third piece is to create a global PaaS, platform as a service. So something that is seated on top of the data architecture and the infrastructure. We are using OpenShift as the platform, but basically we are using Kubernetes as the container runtime engine and Docker as the standard solution for containers. And basically, this is what is going to enable the microservice architecture that is where we are moving to from the big monolithic mainframe-like applications to something that is really distributed and global. And the fourth piece, obviously, this is like the very, very high level view on the platform is security. And the way we have been managing security and the security technology in the bank and big companies is that typically there used to be a department that defines the data solution, and 1 year later they arrive to the security department, and the security department tried to put a lot of things around this data platform so that it's protected, and typically it becomes completely unusable. Now what we have to do is, now this, the IT department is inside everything that we do, so that every design of the architecture, including the data platform, has the security embedded. And I think that there are some good, or some of the speakers that will happen, or the presentation that will happen during this event, they will explain how we are doing that. Because Datio, that is the company that is building our data platform, is a joint venture between Stratio and BBVA. And for example, all the amazing things that they are doing to protect data and integrate Kerberos in every data stream in Kafka and Spark is the core of the security of our platform. The second piece is integration, because this new technology stack should be integrated with the existing platforms. And we have one big mainframe in every country, one big data warehouse based on Teradata, and this platform, this old legacy platform, they are going to stay here for a couple of years. It's not easy. I mean, the movement of workloads and data from one platform to the other is not going to happen in a few weeks. It's going to take 8 or 10 years. So we need to integrate and make sure that the two platforms, or the data, for example, is moved in a smart and smooth way from the mainframes to the new land architecture. And here there are two pieces that are critical. So first, we have decoupled all the channels and product development from the backends through a global service architecture, so that the people that are building the new and amazing product, like Wallet or our mobile app or a new set of product that will arrive to the market in the next couple of months, they could go to a good enough speed and with some kind of decoupling from what is happening in the backend transformation. And the second big piece is Kafka. So we are integrating and we are using Kafka to persist all the data that is being created in the mainframes and in the Teradata to the new platform in real time. So that at some point in time, probably by the beginning next year, we'll have in the new platform exactly the same data than we have in the old platforms, so that people could start building things and training new algorithms using the power in terms of scalability and availability of new technologies of the new technology stack. The third piece of this global platform, and this is much more than only technology, is the new operating model. So imagine the way we have been managing technology in the bank in the last 10 years, and I think this is something that quite usual in most of big companies. And you could expect to hear words like waterfall, or like body shopping, or like software factories. So all these kind of horrible things that makes to work in technology in a bank something not attractive at all. So basically what we are doing also is to redefine completely on how we operate. And we are doing something pretty simple. We want to behave and we want to become a software company rather than the IT or traditional IT department of a bank. And the pieces are very simple. So DevOps and not DevOps. And typically when you talk with a technical audience on DevOps, everyone starts to think on Jenkins or all the tooling around DevOps. But I think that the fundamental thing about DevOps is the people were dimension. So making sure that the developer is in the center, that he's accountable, that we move to a product philosophy where the developers, they have ownership on the work end to end, not just a small piece on all the value chain. Second thing is everything as a service. So we are not being so as radical as Jeff Bezos was being Amazon. but we are strongly pushing that everything should be defined as a software and published in a global API catalog. That is going to take time. We have the first set of APIs available globally. For the time being, it's a reduced number. We have less than around 20, 25 global APIs, but it's the seed to really make sure that everything is consumable as an API. And the third piece is to achieve globality through the open source model. So we strongly believe, and I mean, most of our teams are already contributing to the open source communities that we are, where we have products. We are active contributors to the OpenStack community. We are starting to contribute to the OpenShift community, etc. But also, we want to behave internally as an open source project, so that all the source code is shared in common repositories, so that people could contribute to the source code developed anywhere in the world. We are using the Ubuntu-like community-based model, so where there is a benevolent dictator that makes sure that things evolve in the right direction, but really embracing the principles of the open source community management model. And finally, the fourth piece of this transformation is about having great talent. So a great platform needs great developers. And typically, great developers do not want to work in a company that do not has a great platform. So that creates like a virtual cycle that if you have great developers, you are able to build a great platform. But also happens the opposite. It's impossible to attract, develop, and retain great developers if you don't have a great platform where they could develop. And to do that, we are doing some things that are not very usual in a big company. So for example, from the traditional training methodology that we used to have in big companies, so there is like a HR department 100,000 kilometers far away from where IT people are, that is defining like the training catalog of those courses that no one likes, we have created a ninja academy. And the way we are managing, for example, training in the IT area is through this ninja academy. And basically, what is a ninja academy? Or what are the foundations of the ninja academy? The foundation is that IT people like very much technology. And they do not need that someone in HR told them which training or which courses they have to accomplish. So what we have to do in the Ninja Academy is we have created like a gamification process where and we have defined the ninja paths. So one ninja path is software development, other is data scientist or data science, other is security, etc. And we have defined levels. So yellow belt, green belt, blue belt, etc. And each level requires to accomplish a set of achievements. In some cases, could be to accomplish a training course. In other, could be to have some contribution to an open source community. And the people who validate, I mean, if you have the right level, are your peers. And that creates a feeling of meritocracy and meritocracy based on the technical knowledge and the technical expertise of people. And now the budget that typically we used to have to do these horrible training courses is available so that anyone could ask for a course or for a certification or some kind of finance to go to an event, etc. The second thing is that we are creating an ecosystem of startups. So Datio, as I have mentioned, is a JV between VVA and Stratio. Viva is a company that is very focused in cloud development, or I4S is our software security company. And basically, the reason to build these startups is because people, they feel very good working for a company that has a concrete mission, where they feel relevant, that is designed end-to-end, going from the HR processes to support an specific activity. So Datio, for example, is a company very focused in building the data architecture and has a configuration that is different of I4S that is designed to build security products. And we'll continue growing this kind of startups because people, they like very much to work there And in terms of productivity and speed, they go at a speed of order of magnitude higher than the traditional IT departments inside the bank. And the second thing, I mean, we acknowledge that in a lot of dimensions, we don't have the scale, we don't have the skills. We are creating a set of partnerships, not with a lot of players and not with the traditional players like that you could expect in a bank, like Red Hat or Amazon, Google, or Salesforce, to make sure that they bring us the talent and the expertise to help in building all this platform. And obviously, I mean, we are hiring and we continue hiring a lot of people, not the people you could expect in a bank. What we want is people that are passionate by technology and that are able to do amazing things. And the objective that we have is not just to replicate what we have been doing in the last 50 years of the bank. We want really to do something disruptive in the banking industry. In fact, internally, the building this platform, this IT platform, the name that we give to the project is the World Domination Plan. So I don't know if we'll be able to do it, but it's our intention. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Iñaki. Questions, please? Okay, we have a microphone by the corridors in case you have any question for Iñaki. I have a question for you, Iñaki. So I hope this is one of those cases that will be studied in business schools as a textbook case of digital transformation, data-driven digital transformation. Do you see this process happening also in insurers, in other financial institutions that you are in contact with?
Well, I don't know obviously all the cases. I think that there are financial institutions that are worried by other things like some of the regulatory issues they are having. So this is probably it's not the first priority for them. But I think that most of the institutions in different stages of evolution needs to go in this direction. I don't know if they will use OpenStack or other things, but this type of transformation, not just in the technology side, but also in the business side, is mandatory. I mean, institutions that are not able to transform themselves in the next 5 to 10 years, for sure they will disappear.
Very well. Okay. Okay.
Thank you very much.
I think there's a hand over there. Could you please bring a microphone? Yeah. Please tell your name and your question. Yeah, maybe, sorry, just aloud.
That's a very good question because, in fact, this week the management committee of the bank has like a global meeting, and one of the topics is discuss what to do with the chief data officer. So we used to have a chief data officer in the bank, very focused on regulatory things because typically the banks we've already got a very big demand in terms of data coming from the regulator. So it was. We've got that chief data, and we have a chief data officer that is in the finance area, very focused in achieve the regulatory requirements. And now we are rethinking the role and the position. The position because now data is much more than only regulatory requirements, so it should be in a position that really allows him to have the full vision of the data and the data strategy and the data usage. And there are a couple of options that we are evaluating, going from direct report to the CEO to being in other areas. And in terms of role, clearly the role of the CDO should move from, I mean, support the regulatory requirements to really help the bank in defining the data strategy and set some data priorities in terms on how many data-driven products should we have and make sure that we do the right investment and making sure that we transform our traditional data miners to data scientists, et cetera, et cetera. We have not yet appointed this person and creating this role, but it will happen in the next couple of weeks or few months.
Anyone else? Okay. Yes, over here, please. Oh, there are two. The last two, please, because we're running out of time.
Can you meet? It works? Okay.
Yes.
Good morning. First of all, congratulations for your very good presentation. Secondly, usually the banking in CIO and IT technology takes the decision due to a return of investment. How do you measure the return of the investment of all these projects? Because in a crisis situation for the banking system, to invest to a long time, it's difficult to be able to do this, all these kind of investments, changing the banking system and so on.
Yep.
Thank you.
No, it's a very good question, and I will say that thanks to God, we have been extremely inefficient in the past. We have been so inefficient that we are being able to finance all these things just by taking out some of the inefficiencies. And I'm going to give you two examples. Or before the examples, and one of the reasons is because in the past, I mean, the banks, we have think that creating technology is about investing a lot of money, hiring a lot of people from consultancy firms, et cetera. And now we are moving to a direction where creating technology is about having great people inside that, from a cost perspective, they are order of magnitude cheaper than hiring these consultants. And second, most of the technology that we are using is based on open source. And obviously, we have some companies that give us some support on this open source product, but the orders of magnitude of the new, in terms of cost of the new technology or the new technology stack, is two orders of cost of magnitude less than the previous technology stack. And just to give you an example on, I mean, what are the implications of that? The cost by transaction in the old platform is 0.0085 euros by transaction. In the new platform is 0.0012. So it's like 7 times less than in the old platform. And we have been already able to move, I think that in Spain is close to 12% of the online transactions, on the online core banking transactions, to the new platform. So just the cost reduction by doing this migration has financed, I mean, creating and building the new technology stack in the case of Spain. And this is more on the IT operation and the infrastructure side. On the software development side, imagine the way we do software. The way we do traditionally software in banks is, there is a business user that has an idea. Now some of our business users, for example, in the risk area, they are able not just to define the idea, but to create a model, for example, in Python for the credit scoring model. And the way we productize that and we make it available for our customers is, this guy invests 3-4 months building this model. Then there is a business partner in the IT area that, goes to talk with the risk guy, and typically he hires a consultant so that the consultant translates the Python model to a PowerPoint. Then the business partner takes the PowerPoint to the project manager that typically is in another department within the, and I'm not, I mean, this is the reality of what happens in the bank. Then he gives the PowerPoint to the project manager that typically is in a software development area. This guy typically hires another consultant to translate the PowerPoint to a Microsoft Word detailed software specification. And typically, the project manager from a an outside company that is the one who built the solution typically moves the work to some kind of specification for a software factory. The cost of doing that, if you take the labor cost and all the consultants and all the companies that we hire and all the time that we waste, moving from Python to PowerPoint to Word to whatever we do to sell the project to a software factory, are millions of euros. If you compare that to having a small DevOps team working in the risk area so that the people in the risk area has 3 or 4 data developers that help him to build and productize the algorithms since the beginning, it's 2-3 orders of magnitude less. So to build a business case of doing that is extremely easy, because in the moment where we put the software development teams working in the new way, and in the moment where we start to move the workloads to the new environment, the cost reduction is so massive that and the business case and the return of investment is so obvious that it's been extremely easy to finance everything.
Thank you. We don't have time for more. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.